الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. إن شاء الله we're going to continue studying together سورة البقرة. As you know, سورة البقرة is the longest سورة in the Quran. It's 286 آيات. And سورة البقرة has the greatest آية in the Quran, which is آية الكرسي. And سورة البقرة has so many benefits. In the beginning of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divided the creation into three categories. The believers, the disbelievers, and the hypocrites. And there are many other benefits in Surah Al-Baqarah. We reach this ayah right here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ وَقْتُلُوهُمْ حَيْثَ ثَقِفْتُمُوهُمْ وَأَخْرِجُوهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ أَخْرَجُوكُمْ وَالْفِتْنَةُ أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْقَتْلِ وَلَا تُقَاتِلُوهُمْ عِنْدَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ حَتَّى يُقَاتِلُوكُمْ فِيهِ فَإِنْ قَاتَلُوكُمْ فَاقْتُلُوهُمْ كَذَلِكَ جَزَاءُ الْكَافِرِينَ فَإِنْ انْتَهَوْا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ وَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَا تَكُونَ فِتْنَةٌ وَيَكُونَ الدِّينُ لِلَّهِ فَإِنْ انْتَهَوْا فَلَا عُدْوَانَ إِلَّا عَلَى الظَّالِمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, look how Allah gives us guidelines. Islam is not a religion that is chaotic. Go and blow up and kill people. No, this is not Islam. This is not Islam. Islam is a religion of order. A religion of adab, etiquettes. Dawabit, guidelines. Islam is not chaotic. Look, subhanallah, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the guidelines when it comes to the affair of fighting and killing. He said, the noble verses are a decree of discharging jihad and fighting Allah's cause. When the Muslims gain strength after their migration to Mecca, to Medina. Because when they were in Medina, they were overpowered. They were overpowered. And that shows you right there that when you are in a situation of weakness, you don't expose yourself to destruction. You don't expose yourself to destruction because you don't have the power to fight the enemy. You are in a state of weakness. But when you gain strength and you have the power to fight, yes, you can fight. But before that, don't get emotionally driven. Like a lot of people, they get emotionally driven even though they don't have the capability of fighting the enemy. They don't have the power to fight the enemy, and they get emotionally driven, and then before you know it, they wipe them out. They wipe them out. That is not wisdom. That is foolishness. So Allah imparted on them the consent to fight. So Allah gave them the permission to go ahead and fight. Whereas prior to this, they were ordered to refrain from fighting, blending the word fight with the phrase in Allah's cause is a persuasion for Muslims to be sincere and abstain from quarreling. So that shows you right there that whenever you do something, it has to be based upon sincerity. It has to be based upon sincerity. Because when you don't do it for the sake of Allah, then that work is in vain. That work is in vain. As Al-Imam Sahl ibn Abdillah At-Tastari rahimahullah said, he said, الدُّنْيَا جَهْلٌ وَمَوَاتٌ إِلَّا الْعِلْمُ وَالْعِلْمُ كُلُّهُ حُجَّةٌ إِلَّا الْعَمَلُ بِهِ وَالْعَمَلُ كُلُّهُ هَبَاءٌ إِلَّا الْإِخْلَاصُ وَالْعَمَلُ كُلُّهُ هَبَاءٌ إِلَّا الْإِخْلَاصُ وَالْإِخْلَاصُ عَلَى خَطَرٍ حَتَّى يُخْتَمَ بِهِ. الله أكبر. So when he spoke about al-ikhlas, sincerity, he said all deeds are in vain except if they are coupled with sincerity. Because when you don't do it for the sake of Allah, there is no point. You lose all the tawab, you lose all the reward. But when you do something for the sake of Allah, even though it is a little, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you tremendously for that. Look at that hadith of that woman prostitute from the children of Israel. What did she do? She gave a dog water to her. Because the dog was licking the dirt because he was so thirsty. So she scooped up the water from the well and she gave this dog to drink. She did it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah forgave all his sins. You see. So sincerity is an important ingredient. Without it, al-a'mal, the good deed will not be accepted. And the second one, al-ulama, they mentioned, it has to be in compliance with the sharia. Because someone may be very sincere, but he does not do it in compliance with the sharia. He does not do it according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands him to do, or his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Shaykh, he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said to be sincere and abstain from quarreling and argumentation amongst each other during period of turmoil. Why? Because when you argue at the time of turmoil, then the Muslim Ummah will split, right or wrong. Because what happened in Andalusia, Spain? You know that Muslims, they ruled Spain for Andalusia, Spain for 750 years of Islamic civilization. And when they start quarreling, then they split. When they split, they were taken out. That's it. They were defeated. Those who fight you means fight against those who are preparing to fight against you. It is a reference to the young and healthy disbelievers who have the ability to fight, and not the old and feeble who can neither fight nor give military advice to the enemy. Prohibition to not transgress the limits includes all actions of cruelty and oppression, such as killing women. Islam does not encourage killing women. We don't kill women. When we fight, even our enemy, we don't kill their women. Even though they kill our women, but we don't kill their women. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he advised us not to do that. Children, we don't kill children. They're insane also. Someone is crazy. You go and kill them. No, this is not right. And the priest, those who are in their churches and things like that, you don't kill them. You don't kill them. Who do not partake in the fighting, cruelty and oppression also encompasses disgracing of the dead. Like you take a person out, you kill him, and then you cut him up, or you cut his tongue, or something like that. This is what? Mutla. This haram. Mutla. Mutilation. Mutilation is haram. Disgrace in the body. This is not permissible in Islam. Look, subhanAllah, at this adab. Look at this etiquette of the religion of Islam. Disgracing the dead who were killed during a war. Killing of animals and cattle without any valid reason. You look, subhanAllah, Islam protects the environment. And it's not a chaotic religion. You don't just go and kill animals unless there is a reason for you to kill an animal. Some people, they do it for sport, subhanAllah, and they kill so many animals. And they're happy and laughing and things like this. This is haram. This is haram. If you have to kill an animal at the time of the season, like when they give you the authorization to go, you have a license, and you go kill a deer or a turkey or something like that, no problem, inshallah. Because you're going to kill it to eat it. You're not going to kill it just to throw it on the side of the road. La. The Sheikh, he said, cutting down trees also. It's not permissible to go and cut down the trees. Look how Islam protects the environment. And things of a similar nature, because they are all forbidden, as they do not bring any benefit to the Muslims. If the disbelievers agree to pay the prescribed jizya, then to fight against them would also be considered as cruelty. If there is an agreement between us and them that they are not going to fight us, rather they are going to pay the jizya, the protection money. So they are going to pay the protection money to the Muslim government. So when they do that, we don't attack them or harm them or anything like that, because we have a treaty with them. Likewise, when we have a treaty with the kuffar also, when we come to their land, like here we come to the U.S., or people go to the U.K. and the like, you have a treaty with them. You don't transgress the limits. You have to respect the law of the land. Some people, they say, well, it's permissible to cheat the non-believers. Who said it is permissible? And they cheat them in the insurance, and they abuse the system. This is haram. Unfortunately, there are many Muslims who do that in Europe and U.S. and other than that. They trick the government, and they take the money from the government, and they're like, it's haram. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Man ghashana falaysa minna." Another hadith, "Man ghasha falaysa minna." He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever cheats us or deceives us is not one of us. Another hadith, he said, whoever cheats or deceives is not one of us. Islam is not a religion of treachery. Islam is a straightforward religion, alhamdulillah. It teaches you to be upright. It teaches you to be direct. Not to be sneaky or shady or the like. This is not Islam. You go and abuse the system and say, well, they're kuffar. Yes, even if they're kuffar, you have to respect them. You have a treaty with them. The Sheikh, he said, as they do not bring any benefit to the Muslims, if the disbeliever agree to pay the prescribed jizya, then to fight against them would also be considered as cruelty and oppression, and is therefore forbidden. It's haram. Once you have a treaty with them, that's it. You don't transgress. You don't break that treaty that they have with you. You have to respect them. Just respect them. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, he commands us to do that. He says, "Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, awfu bil'uqud." Or you believe, fulfill your contract. And he also said, "Al-Muslimuna ala shurutihim." The Muslims, they are to abide by their conditions. So for example, when you marry a woman, and she has a condition on you. He said, "I will marry you, but you teach me the Quran. Or you teach me the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Or you make hijrah to a Muslim land," or something like that. Then this condition is valid, because it is not against the Sharia. But if she stipulates something that is haram, then you don't fulfill that. You don't fulfill the condition if it is haram. And being truthful is from the characteristic of the believers. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, it says, "Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu." "Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, taqullaha wa kunu ma'as-sadiqin." He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, "Oh, you believe, fear Allah and be with the truthful ones." No matter what, you always have to say the truth. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Alaykum bis-sidq. فَإِنَّ الصِّدْقَ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْبِرِّ وَإِنَّ الْبِرَّ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَمَا زَالَ الرَّجُلُ يَصْدُقُ وَيَتَحَرَّ الصِّدْقَ حَتَّى يُكْتَبَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ صِدِّيقًا." He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at the fruits and the benefit of being truthful. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, be truthful. Because truthfulness leads to righteousness. And righteousness leads to al-Jannah. And a man and a woman keeps saying the truth until they are written with Allah as Siddiqeen. SubhanAllah. Allahu Akbar. Can you imagine that you are written as a truthful servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And be aware of lying, he said. وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَالْكَذِبِ فَإِنَّ الْكَذِبَ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْفُجُورِ وَإِنَّ الْفُجُورِ يَهْدِي إِلَى النَّارِ وَمَا زَالَ الرَّجُلُ يَكْذِبُ وَيَتَحَرَّ الصِّدْقَ يَتَحَرَّ الْكَذِبَ حَتَّى يُكْتَبَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَدَّابًا. He said to Allah, be aware of lying, because lying leads to evil, and evil leads to the hellfire. And a man or woman keeps lying until they're written with Allah as liars. And also from the characteristic of the hypocrite, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, he said, إِذَا حَدَّثَ كَدَبْ إِذَا حَدَّثَ كَدَبْ وَإِذَا وَعَدَ خَانْ. So these are some of the characteristics of the hypocrite. The first one, when he speaks in lies. This is a hypocrite. He does not say the truth. And the second one, when he promises, he breaks the promise. وَلَيَّدُ بِاللَّهِ. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.